Today's anthem, the choir Morrissey, who's dedicated in his memory because it was his favorite song. And so we will greatly miss him. And I'm so glad we get to see him once in a while. Anything else this morning? Then let us prepare our hearts and our minds to worship God. Thank you. Collection. Does anyone here have a collection of anything? Yeah, what do you collect? Rocks, yeah. Rocks. Coins, that's the one. Seashells, what about you guys? Rocks, there's a lot of rock collectors. Buttons coming along, so I brought some of my more colorful buttons. And my red strawberry button. Thank you, I like it too. I had a blue car button. They don't smell. You have a marble snack? An orange button? But I don't see my big pink button in here. I think I might have dropped it. Does anyone see my pink button? It's like a big pink button. Oh, you know what? I think it's in here. There it is! I thought I lost it for a minute. You sure can see it. It is a big pink button. Who has lost something before? Yeah, lost stuff. Absolutely. And it seems kind of silly, you know, you lose your pink button, or you lose your favorite coin, you lose your favorite toy, and you spend so much time looking for it. Whose mom or dad or grandparents have lost their keys? Yeah. And did you spend a long time looking for those? Yeah, those pairs. So it seems kind of silly sometimes that we get so upset when we lose one little thing. But that's how God feels about us too. Sometimes we can get confused or sad, and God still cares about us. God is sad when we feel lost. And God is really happy when we feel found and we feel welcome and happy. Okay? So I want you to keep that in mind. Each one of you is a special part of God's collection of people. Each one of you is unique and beautiful and wonderful, and we're so grateful to have you here, and God is so glad that you're here. All right. Now we're going to do something special today. Samantha Mazikovich. Hallelujah. Yes, practicing all morning. Samantha is getting her Bible today. She's in third grade. And what we're going to do is I'm going to have all of you are going to help me bless this Bible for Samantha so that when she gets it and starts reading it, it will be special to her. So let's all gather around. We've got to make a circle around. All right. Good job. Good job. Let's make a circle so everyone can see. Christopher, I know you're short, but you're doing well. Good job. All right. So this is going to be a repeat after me prayer. So I'm going to say something and then you repeat it. Right? All right, let's go. Dear God,
dear God,
bless this Bible.
Bless this Bible.
For Samantha.
For Samantha.
As she reads it.
As she reads it.
And learns about God.
And learns about God.
Amen. Good job. So Samantha, this is for you. You're very welcome. And we're going to do our Lord's Prayer now, and all the adults are going to help us. If you don't know the words, that's okay. You can listen to. We're going to do it all together all year so we can all learn it together, right? So if everyone can hold hands. All right, let's pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
All right, have fun your first day of Sunday school. Be good for your teacher.
Thank you.
I'm going to read to you this morning from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, 1 through 10. We're right in the midst of a lot of Jesus' parables, and so you'll hear yet another one today. And remember, Jesus' parables are usually not as straightforward as they seem, so we need to listen closely to the words Jesus uses so that we can hear what he's saying, and it might be something different for each one of us. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to him, and the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. Which of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who need their repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I have lost." Just so I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving God, let us hear your word to us today. Let us meditate upon it in our hearts and speak its truth to those whom we encounter when we leave this place. Amen. So let's talk about being lost. We just heard about a lost sheep and a lost coin. It's no secret that people get lost too. But this story is also about joy. It's easy for us to focus on the issue of being lost and of being found, and how the Pharisees and the scribes are unhappy, how they think Jesus was avoiding judgment, and so on. But we are missing the common denominator in all of these stories, joy. We hear, just so there will be more joy in heaven. And I get that. I have been lost. Every summer, I went to Cape Cod for 2 weeks with my cousin, who was 4 months older than I was. Never let me forget that. And my aunt would take 2 weeks off from work, and we would sit down, and we'd make a list of all the things we wanted to do in our 2 weeks, and we'd hang it on the refrigerator and cross things off as we did them. And always top of the list was going to Waterloo. It's the best water park in the world, or so I thought. You've been to the Cape, you'll know Waterloo is right there. And it was our absolute favorite thing to do, especially because it would be hot in the summer. And at that time, our favorite part of the water park was sitting in one of those double tubes and going round and round in the lazy river. All the other rides had long lines, but once you got in the lazy river, you didn't have to get out until you wanted to. So it was the best way to spend all your time in the water. So we would do that. We'd get redder and redder in the sun. And one summer when we were about 7, we arrived at Waterwoods after a highly anticipated sleepless night and immediately headed to Lazy River. And unfortunately, that day they didn't have one of those double tubes, so we were each in our own. And we went around and around until I suddenly realized I couldn't see my cousin anymore, who'd been right next to me. And I eventually got so panicked I got out, and I couldn't find my aunt, who had been sitting there in a beach chair just a moment before. And growing more and more frantic, I jogged around looking for them, getting more and more scared. And a very nice lifeguard noticed and took me to every little kid's nightmare, the lost area, with the little plastic chairs and the coloring books that were even colored. And I probably only waited for about 10 minutes before my aunt heard the overhead page and got me. It seemed like hours. When I finally saw them come around the corner, I thought I would be filled with shame or mad that they weren't where they were supposed to be. But honestly, all I remember was relief, and even more than that, joy. I had been lost, but I was found, I was safe, I was where I was supposed to be. I was filled with pure joy. I'm sure many of you have gotten lost or had a child or grandchild wander off. I'm sure many of you felt the same emotions that I did. Maybe you felt the pure joy yourself when reunited. And that's exactly how God feels anytime anyone is drawn back into relationship with God. Anytime someone chooses life or lives into their potential, anytime someone helps another, in all of these things, joy is found. Pure joy. The Pharisees and the scribes don't really get that. They don't realize that God is mostly about love rather than elevating rules. We forget that too. God is about joy rather than anger or fear or impatience or all the other things that we might think God is about. What would it be like if we invited our friends and our family to places of joy, to be joyful with one another? Anytime one of God's children discovers the truth of abundant life God wants for all of us. How amazing would that be? I just gave an example of being physically lost, but we are surrounded by people and can still feel desperately alone. There are people all around us who seem to have it all, have everything together, and yet they are still hopelessly lost. You can be a righteous person and be lost. Having it all together, looking perfect to an outsider is great, but it's still okay to feel lost. Church is a place for those who feel lost. It's a place where we can have those feelings and confide our hopes and fears, our dreams and our failings to God. And we should be confident that any time we turn towards God, God throws a big party and invites all the angels to participate. In the end, this parable isn't about the sinner or the righteous person. It's not even about being lost or being found. It's about a God that loves us so much that God will do anything to find one of God's children. Which of you, Jesus asks us, would go to such great lengths to search and find and then welcome back and celebrate? I looked for something like a coin, even something like a sheep. It was a chicken, but I didn't throw a big party idea. I was more just relieved. But Jesus reminds us that God does have this extravagant celebration anytime this happens, because God does everything, risks everything to seek us out, lighting lamps and sweeping until we are all caught up in God's mercy, grace, and love. We often spend our time focused on the lostness of ourselves and of each other. We worry about being lost and being found. And when we do this, we miss the joyful character of these stories. We should also take note that in both stories we heard, there is far less attention to the lost than there is on the one who is searching. These stories, my friends, are not just about lost sheep or lost coins. They're about a shepherd who risks everything to go and look, and about a woman who stays up all night sleeping to find her lost coin. These stories are about a God who will always go looking for God's lost children, looking even more fervently than when I was lost and looking for my family. We should also take note that the people representing God in this story, a shepherd who would have stood at the very bottom of the socioeconomic ladder in first century Palestine, and a woman who may have only had 10 silver coins to her name, we should realize that these aren't just metaphors. They are a reminder that God also works through ordinary people to do the extraordinary work of helping to find someone. On September 11, 2001, 18 years ago this past week, Wells Crowther went to work just like he did every day as an equities trader in the World Trade Center. After the second tower was hit, the one where he worked, Mr. Wells led everyone he could find down steps to safety, and then he went back to look for more people. And he led those people to safety, and he went back again and again and again until the tower collapsed. That day, a talented, athletic, good-natured, but ordinary person did an extraordinary thing. He gave his life so that other people would live. On that day, God used Wells Crowther to find people who were lost. We don't normally, thank God, find ourselves in those types of situations. And yet God still does use us to help find others. Not only can God use us, but God does and will, despite our best laid plans. At work, at home, at school, through our faith communities, the places where we volunteer, God regularly uses us to find others. What if our church, our community, could be a place of joy where we hear that God is regularly using ordinary people like us to find others and create even more joy? I think that would be amazing. It would be more than amazing. It would be extraordinary. Even better than that, if you're able to do this to find others who are lost, I guarantee that there will be joy in heaven even more than we can imagine. So if you find yourself wandering, feeling a little lost, if you see someone struggling, remember it's not just about the lostness, it's about searching. It's about going back again and again and again to help others so that they may live. Let us go forth and do so. Amen.
Thank you. Let us hear the good news when we are still.
Let us believe the good news through trust in God's promises. We lift up all those on our prayer list, those who are listening at home. We lift up all those who are struggling, who feel lost, for those in time of mourning. Holy Lord, you have given to us your servant's grace by the confession of a true faith, to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity and in the power of our divine majesty to work, worship, and unity. Keep us steadfast in this faith and worship. Bring us at last to see you in your one and eternal glory. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now I'd like to invite up our chair of the mission committee, Christina Raybaugh-Hall, who's going to share a minute of mission. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm talking for a few minutes about the Peace and Global Witness Special Offering. And unlike the one great hour of sharing, we conveniently have the appropriate envelopes tucked in the pew in front of you so you can slip a little something in the envelopes. Peacemaking is something that happens among leaders of countries warring over issues, rights, and land. Certainly this is true, but it's also true that peace is made by many others, even you and me. Conflict arises in our families and communities. Instability threatens our livelihoods, and even our safest places like schools, malls, churches, playgrounds can be permeated by violence and brokenness. In stark contrast to this conflict and brokenness all around us are the words of the Apostle Paul. May God grant us peace at all times in all ways. Peace in our families, in our work, in our communities, in our world, and in our minds. That peace is the peace of Christ. The Peace and Global Witness Offering draws Presbyterians together, providing education and exposure to those doing active peacemaking here in our neighborhoods and all over the world. It aims to form peacemakers who advocate for Christ's peace everywhere. When the congregation of First Presbyterian Church in Arlington, Virginia, learned that one of their neighbors was facing deportation, they found an opportunity to work for justice and peace just outside their church doors. Knowing the complex array of issues that can make achieving justice in such a difficult case, they paired the local organization for help. Using the retained portion of their Peace and Global Witness Offering, the congregation supported the Congregation Action Network. This network of faith and communities seeks to show love, compassion, and hospitality in the face of hate and discrimination. A primary focus for them is deportation defense, using all available venues and options to keep immigrants in their communities from being sent out of our country. I'd like to explain that 50% of this offering supports the work and peace done by the Presbyterian Mission Agency. With another 25% joins with the gifts of others in the Presbytery and the Synod to support peacemaking regionally. And the other 25% will remain here in West Hampton for our mission committee to donate. So following the retirement of the Wardens, I don't know if you remember them visiting us in April of 2017, the mission committee is looking for place that portion of the giving. The mission committee has decided to sponsor missionaries in this hemisphere, in the Americas. Perhaps Mark Adams on the Mexican border, or Cesar Carrachin in Colombia, who helps Venezuelan refugees. We also have supported the Coalition to Stop Gun Violence since Jim Atwood was here for the World Communion Sunday back in 2015. So our portion of the Peace and Global Witness Special Offering will go in one of these two directions, either to help immigrants in the Americas or national gun violence. As Presbyterians, we proclaim that Jesus Christ is Prince of Peace and the model of compassion, kindness, and grace for every community and individual in this world.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God, refuge and healing, call us back to who you created us to be. Invite us into your ministry of recollection, reconciliation, and inspire us to be peacemakers in every part of our lives. Amen.
Thank you.